Very good afternoon, respected ma'am and other panelists on the dais. Ma'am, from this morning, we have been sufficiently educated about the steel quality and the need for standards. Morning, Mr. Sudhanshu talked about the India's historical route in making the steel. And subsequently, many of the speakers, they talked about the need for quality control order is inbuilt, is based on the safety, security, safety and security of the people of the country. And with this background, we will now start this session of adoption of quality control standards. And nobody is more suited than our Madam Joint Secretary Ruchika Govil to chair this session. Thank you.
On the dais and all the friends who are sitting across the room. It's my privilege to be here today at this forum to discuss about the mandatory quality control orders. Monica has worked very hard to put together this forum. She's been in discussions with us for a long time. I congratulate Monica for finally getting this very important discussion up for debate today. The BIS Act 2016 under Section 16 allows the quality control orders made by BIS to be made into mandatory quality control orders. The standards can be made into mandatory quality control orders. And that is where the role of Ministry of Steel comes in. We do play the role in the central government of mandating these standards to be made into the mandatory quality control orders. It is to debate this today we have on the panel important personalities here. Before we go further, I think we would like to hear most of the panelists' views on how they perceive these mandatory quality control orders. I think in the morning sessions, we have already discussed the importance of quality steel in the country for the the country is now at an advanced stage. It's a developed economy working towards becoming more of into developed products. Quality steel is going to be important. So I think today we have with us all the producers and consumers in some form or the other who are on the panel here. I think we would like to hear their comments, raise the questions. I think then the House could also ask the panelists or the chair questions. I would be happy to coordinate this whole exercise in this panel today. I'd like to start from the end, if we could hear your comments in that regard. Yeah. I would request all the panelists to give us about 2 to 3 minutes views on this topic, raise the concerns that they feel are relevant to their industry, and then we will take it forward. It's up to you. Please feel comfortable. Either you could be there or you could be sitting here. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Chairperson, esteemed members on dais and guests. Thank you. I have been associated with the steel industry for just about 2 years, and so I think I'm the least qualified to speak. But I just jotted out a few points based on my understanding in the last couple of years in the corporate world. I was with the government, and based on what I heard in the morning as well. See, I think the objectives of it's called the Steel and Steel Products Quality Control Order. The objectives are very clear. Green India, quality is a religion, consumer is the priority, which the Union Secretary of Steel said. Steel has shaped our history and likely to shape our future. And Mr. Das tells us that the genesis is 1965 when it was to provide price differences. But now the objective is clearly to ensure quality products to all users, end users and consumers. Now the reality is it is primarily a trade measure which benefits the domestic industry. Can we oppose it? Clearly no, it's a great effort. It benefits the end user, consumers, obviously a great initiative. What is good for the consumer is clearly good for the nation. But from the industry point of it, who's going to enforce it? BIS. Now, it's nice that somebody is enforcing it for the domestic standards. But the fear that we have in the corporate world is that we spend a lot of our time seeking approvals, seeking permissions, grants with the local level, state level, central level. A huge amount of our executive time is actually spent there, which should actually be in improving the quality and improving the markets and improving the production. Now, whatever regulatory bodies should be there, which was clearly said in the morning, should be robust, clean, quick, and delivers and is monitorable themselves, preferably by the steel ministry. Because we don't want to get into the same situation where you seek approval and it is a time-consuming process, which we have seen in the past. What is the alternative? The alternative is what was said in the morning session, which is very, very nice. Go for voluntary acceptance of standards and self-regulation, which is what most of the developing countries are doing. And like some of the developed countries, examples were quoted in the morning where they have either no quality standards laid out or just maybe one or two. The big players, the Steel Authority, the Tata Steels, and the GSW, have set standards, are continuously setting standards, and we will emulate them. We will not only emulate their standards, we inbuild our own standards. But I would also like to make mention that there's a huge space for people who are less than 1 million capacity. There's a huge space. So it's not only the big players that are there, it's even the other people who are there. And every steel product that is produced by the mid-segment or the small players, I wouldn't say MSME, but the mid-segment or the small players, has its market in a huge, diverse country like ours. And I'm not getting into discriminate products, discriminate quality, discriminate consumers. I'm not getting into that at the moment. I don't think that's the purpose of this thing. But we will set voluntary standards for ourselves. And I think that's the best way to enforce quality control. And I think when we go for our training sessions, Japan has this very nice 5S, which we are all aware of: sort, straighten, shine, standardize, and sustain. Since the time is short, I'm not going to dwell further, but from the industry point of view, I would like to mention a couple of points which possibly are not too relevant with the subject, which is quality control for products. To produce quality steel in our premises, we expect quality service from the government and the regulatory authorities and the people who are ordained to provide services. The Tata Steel MD in the morning video says, in-plant efficiencies vis-a-vis outside steel plant inefficiencies, the infrastructure, the roads. For a giant which is more than 100 years old, faces this. What about the smaller players? We face this day in and day out. Could we expect quality services in addition to the quality products that you are expecting us to manufacture, and we will manufacture, to ensure the production of quality goods? It seems that there are certain organizations, I can say for the banking sector with my own personal example, that there's a huge fear psychosis. There's no delivery and people are not ready to take decisions, which has landed up into a huge liquidity problem. I was in a National Steel Committee meeting of CII last afternoon with the union secretary, and this point was thrashed and debated at length, where we are now requesting the steel ministry to intervene and request RBI and the MDs of the major banks to come and intervene, where we would like the steel, the ministry to intervene and provide quality services to us to ensure that we will provide quality products. I have two suggestions. One is, of course, taken up by the chair, and I'll end with that because time is short. That, you know, in a session like this, which is so well organized by Metalogic and Monica, thank you so much, we would expect the participants to ask panelist discussions. Like in the morning, I would have had a few sessions. For future sessions, if you can leave some space for people who come from outside, come and ask questions. And the second is, the steel ministry has come up with a wonderful scrap policy, and which is up for debate and there. Is it possible to link that up with this quality control order or otherwise and take it up for discussion in a beautiful seminar like this? Thank you for your time.
I'm representing Indian stainless steel industry. Just a quick brief of the industry. It's the second largest industry in the world at this moment, second largest production, as well as second largest consumer of stainless steel in the world also. So we produce more than 3.5 million tons, this 3.74. And stainless steel is a very distinct industry, although it is a very small part of the steel industry, but in terms of value, it might be 10 to 12%. And this goes into all kinds of applications, so you can understand there are many, many grades and varieties of stainless steel being produced and used in the country. Our domestic industry, since beginning, they have supported the idea of quality control order. And the quality is, I can give a quick example, like when the quality control order was applied, many of the industry came forward, not just the primary producer, but the secondary also. And today we have more than 47 licenses from domestic producer and as well as from the foreign producers, which is more than 24 licenses. So almost everyone who is a part of this industry has gone ahead and taken the license. For the quality control order, we have six standards from stainless steel into it. flat standards which are 6911 and specifically two standards for utensil and kitchen appliances and the long product standards which were recently added into it. Now coming to the my point is that this process, what I see, is a dynamic process, and by dynamic I mean it's evolving in the sense that suppose our own standards, BIS standards, which were a little old standards, which has been revised now. In last year only, in the 6911, which is a flat standard, more than 100 grades were added, and it is now not only equivalent to any international standard, but in certain aspects, because when we talk of standard, it's just not the chemical composition, it is about other properties and other tolerances, dimensional tolerance, surface finish. So many aspects of standard has to be followed to improve the quality of the end product which is reaching to the consumer. In certain aspects, the flat standards has become even better in some terms. And as I see, just a very, very quick example on product standards also. This, ma'am, there was this stainless steel milk cans, and it is supposed to be very hygienic and very promising product. But once I inquired about what is happening, why the production is going down for the milk can, it came to our notice that the handles are getting off, or it is not easy to clean those milk can. And I was very surprised, because stainless steel is supposed to be very easily cleaned. So when I came to know, that there are many manufacturers in our country who are, you know, doing without any standard on milk can. They were doing it in their own way, and there were so many problems related to that. Once the standard was missed, every other manufacturer started following those standards, and the improvement in the quality of that product happened. So QCO, in terms of just not raw material standard, but in product standards also, has improved as far as consumer is concerned. And as I said, it is a dynamic process, like say for the utensils, which is a big part of our stainless steel industry. Many of you are aware that, you know, earlier 304 grade was very prominent in it. Then 200 series grade came, and because of the cost effectiveness of it. So there was a standard, separate standard made for low nickel austenitic stainless steels. And these standards once again is under revision. A lot of tests are going on to ascertain whether those grades which are being used in the country are suitable or not. So it's a dynamic process. This process will continue. It will keep on improving the quality controller in the long run. So that's what I wanted.
Thank you, Rohit. Rohit actually also helps us on our technical committee of the Ministry of Steel, which actually gives clarifications regarding whether certain standards, grades are covered or not covered by the existing quality control orders. So I think more than anybody else here, Rohit is in a very good position to appreciate as to how dynamic this world of steel is, as to how continuously new grades and new standards of steel are being innovated upon. I think one of the challenges we see in that committee is that the new product which has, you know, which comes to us for consideration, whether that is truly a new grade, a new standard, whether it is innovation or whether it is just a mischief of somebody just tweaking an existing product, whether it is something which could actually take the steel industry to a new direction, new height, satisfy the demand for a special type of steel, or whether it is just somebody tweaking an existing product. Thank you, Rohit, for your inputs.
Thank you.
Yeah. I would now like to call Mr. Dutta to give his comments, please.
Yeah, good afternoon. Dignitaries on the dais, off, and ladies and gentlemen. I am from automobile industry. Hyundai Motor is the second largest automaker in India, and Hyundai as a group is the fifth largest in the world. And in India, we are the largest exporters. For the last 20 years, all the steel that you are making is part of our car, and which is being exported to more than 86 countries. You must be proud to say that whenever you go to any of these European countries, Gulf, Africa, Latin America, you can proudly say that this car is our steel and made in India. When that kind of quality, we definitely appreciate the quality of the steel that are made here. At the same time, I must also say that the recent BIS standard, whatever has come in now, has put a lot of, improved quality, rather, I must say. With that also, our imports also has been coming down. Now, earlier we used to get about 40% import and 60% used to be the domestic. Now, slowly we are increasing it. Now, we have, I think, touched about 70 plus. And year after year, this percentage is increasing. Domestic, we are more steel we are buying. And the other part that I must say is because of this quality, critical parts we still are importing, and these parts are also going into our export of cars. Why these critical parts are more important or why we are importing is basically because of the safety standards and the standards in those countries. If there is any failure, if any part is identified as a responsible for this particular accident or an incident, the whole part has to be called work and there will be a negative impact on the brand. So many of the car manufacturers, you will keep seeing in the media reports saying that they have called for so many different reasons. So that's the reason why some of the parts we are for that requirement we are still importing still. Otherwise, most of it is domestic. Now coming to the quality of the product as such, what we are using the steel, and about 600 to 750 kgs of the steel goes into each of the car that we are making depending on the size of the car. And some of the cars have won awards. Five times we have won ICOT award, which no other company in India have won. And one of our cars, Santro, which is recently introduced in the world, which were rated as the best, one was from India and Santro car. So this kind of quality and that product that goes into it has been appreciated well by the world over. Now our request is, as an automobile industry representative, my suggestion or request is, still there is a scope for improvement. Still there is a scope for better quality, better standards, and we will move towards that. Make in India definitely is a very good initiative, so that many of these products are still coming into India. Even though 94% of our car is a product, whole thing is manufactured in India, there is still scope for 6% which is being imported from outside. And there is also scope for improving our own exports. Even though we are exporting to 86 countries, there is scope for improving this further. So we are also looking at one of our own sister company, Kia Motors, has also set up plant here. So the steel requirement is definitely going up and growing. So with this, I must say that consistent quality and better product will definitely make sure that what we buy from you and what we make for the ultimate consumer will definitely stand the test of time. And also these awards will indicate that how good is our product and how good is the steel that you are making. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Datta. I think the steels that are being used today in automobile industries are so varied, and I think the scope is perpetually increasing and challenging. I think in Ministry of Steel, we have a continuous dialogue with SIAM on the number of grades and standards of steel that are currently being produced and need to be produced and also be brought within the scope of the existing standards, how they need to be upgraded, how there's perpetually some new grade which is being innovated upon somewhere in the world. I think our BIS here is perpetually catching up with the amount of innovation we see in the automobile industry. And yes, we are aware that now a lot of localization has happened from anywhere between 88 to 98% for different brands. The steels are, local steels are being used. But we do hope that in the country now we will shortly see 100% of the steels that are required. The country has the capability, and there are producers who are willing to make and produce each grade of steel that would be required by the automobile industry. We look forward to working very closely for developing all those grades. Next speaker, we have Mr. Ravinder Bhan from ISA.
Madam Ruchika and dignitaries on the dais, and Mr. Das, we have been working, who is there in front of us. We have been working on the quality standards since 2007, and it gradually took, and the resistance on the quality control reduced. There were slides, but I shuffled through, and there are some focus point highlights which have been marked in red front. That is basically the important point of that slide, which we'd like to share with you.
It needs to go to ICU within experts to make steel of world-class quality ourselves. Till then, nothing would happen.
Sir, could you give us more specific sort of suggestions?
I'll give you an example. The entire car can run. You make the valve of the engine of a low quality, the car will break down. The criticality is required in every aspect. We cannot treat steel like the medicines in OPD. The patient is handled in OPD in a different way. We're handling steel in the OPD manner all the time. I've been hearing since morning. We're making jokes on it. We're talking about it. We've not understood. We don't, now we want to be number one in the world.
Not the backups.
We don't want to be the leaders in the world. We just want to be copycats. Why can't we be the leaders? Why can't we all become leaders of the country? And why can't we think country first? Why do we think profit first? Why do we think quality first? All the time profit, 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 all the time. I think the attitude has to change. You have to love our country. Unless you love your country, you can't produce quality goods. Go to Japan, go to Korea, you listen to them. They love their country. They don't give excuses for failures.
Sir, I think
we are ready to give excuses for every failure that we can make, everywhere.
Sir, I think
we love to do that.
Yes,
thank
sir,
you.
We appreciate the point. I think the role of BIS is to set up a standards, to set up the grades, but then it is self-regulation. We have to have an area where people actually want, have the desire to produce the best quality steel. I think with BIS, the government intervention is to bring quality control order to make it mandatory. But before they are made mandatory, the standards already exist. Would you like to add further? But it is for the producers here.
I have been on the committee in ISI many, many years. I've heard these excuses every time. I've been there since 1981, and today is 2019. The same excuses what you are giving today, we let's look at it, let's look at it, we'll keep looking at it. 21st century also will go away. We'll all go away.
Sir, it is not.
Technology available everywhere in the world. Medicine world, why can't we take the same route of steel like the medicine world?
Sir, if
I think we're all trying to.
I think, sir, we've all got the point.
We're trying to protect the Indian industry for no reason.
I think, sir, everybody's.
I can debate on it for 10
hours. I think
hours.
We can, sir. I think we can take that.
I can debate for 10 hours on this. I will not give up.
Friends, sir, this presentation I have put, I have just. Should I continue, sir? Okay. I think earlier we had basically quality regulations were called is a technical barrier to trade. Now the myth has really gone. And then what is the need for the mandatory quality control orders must have discussed in the forum session. Then users take or stakeholders perspective, that's what exactly we have to basically discuss in the session. And the challenges, what are there and the way forward. Basically now the myth has really gone that technical TBT, technical barrier to trade, is a basically quality regulations. We will see how it really happens in the other countries. You can see. These are the basically I put technical barrier to trade. How many countries? This is initiated by India on all products. This includes the TBTs, that is quality regulations, anti-dumping and all that. We will see the. This is the other countries what they have. It is on all products, not on steel. What they have imposed on India. You can see the, it is 3,496. So the myth is there because every country is also regulating their own quality standards. This slide shows that countries are also imposing lot of quality regulations on the products. Now, we are seeing how many defectives, you can see how many defectives have come, 2018, 19 and April to May. See, almost 367,000. And the defectives are in GPGC, where quality control authority is there. That means monitoring is lacking somewhere. And you can see in 2 months, almost 39,000 tons have already come. These are all defective at seconds. I was just information hopping on the website. Normally they call it research nowadays. I found that there are almost 536 licenses in TMT, and we have almost 341 brands, brand names. How a user, maybe the construction industry, maybe the individual, how they can know whether all the brands are really conforming to some standards? It's only the mandatory quality control, which will ensure, yes, okay, whatever brand maybe is there, at least it is manufactured to a quality, conforming to a quality standard, and basically the processes and procedures what are to be adopted as per the standard that has been adopted. This is how really quality control orders really help. And in India, you know, voluntarily nothing is done, it has to be mandatory. And what is basically a quality standard is basically substandard and harmful, which are imported. And it is not that only it is applied to import. Normally we have a tendency to think we are trying to stop import. It's not that. It is basically to see substandard materials, defective materials don't come in the country. And also it has to be applied to the domestic producers also, domestic suppliers also. They have to also to conform to that standard. And the prime objective, definitely I have just spoken in earlier slide only. Then on the steel front, you can see how many regulations have been imposed by other countries on India. It is on the steel. Earlier I had shown you on the all products. You can see that it is almost, TBT is almost 218, incession and enforce, 47. And what India has done? We have only imposed only two. That is basically two orders came, where almost 53 products and 13 products were notified. And what basically we are doing, we are only dimensional, chemical imposition, tolerances, packaging, delivery conditions, that's what normally our control standards are indicating. In general, these are the parameters which our quality controls generally have. And these are the licenses or whatever is available for the quality control orders which have been notified. And if you really see, as per ISO technical board, who are the stakeholders? I'll be discussing basically main is industry and commerce, consumers, standards application, that is the BIS, may the ministry. These are the basically the important stakeholders. So far user perspective is concerned. And I think there is again a shift in this, that current industry, our focus was earlier on that we should have volumes. The quality was slightly going on the backdrop. And there is a need for a paradigm shift from quantity to quality, keeping the downstream or user industry's requirement in view. That's exactly is the user industry perspective. Make in India vision can take leap, jump if the quality is kept as a long-term goal to create global quality image of the Indian product. That is exactly what should be our focus. This will also help the user industry to compete globally. Integration of quality standards with end-use application performance is a must. What are the challenges? If you really see, requirement in some sectors or projects, the companies have to demonstrate prior experience in Japan. I'm telling you, Japan is what they normally do. In fact, Mr. The prize here, who is from the Hyundai, there is a sort of, you can say, de facto ruling there, that unless you have experience or you are producing the steel, no other industry can come inside. That is basically what is going on there in Japan. And what are the projects which are funded? There is almost a proportion of the steel, Japanese steel we have to use, that also is indicated. And again, a number of automotive companies within the regional tie-up contracts with domestic steel producers of their own origin country, that is Hyundai Steel and Hyundai Automotive, Nippon Steel, Honda and Toyota, JEF. That is basically a sort of understanding with them. But they will have to use Japanese steel. And implementation challenges, I think you will all agree that overlapping of international standards with multiple BIS standards, overlapping of BIS standards of products for same application end use, too many specifications and fragmented for each small end use specification are made. In a global trade environment, this is a constraint. The main reason that majority of standards have virtually become prehistoric, in fact, they have become archaic. I think earlier, how the standards were made, suppose a person produces a pin or a clip, they use the producer standard. So that is continuing. There is no change in those. We have to really, again, review those and integrate the codes. Otherwise, you will have small codes, number of codes are there, which can be clubbed into one code, because this will reduce the license burden also on the producers and so many other issues. Interlinking of ITC codes with notified BIS submission for easy implementation of trade. This is a very vital topic, because we are trying to sort of put ITC code, we are doing ITC code mapping in some codes. It was a Herculean task. I think Mr. Ashwini is here, and discussing all this, how much difficult it is really to do ITC mapping, because ultimately, whatever trade is done, it is on ITC codes only. Whatever comes from abroad, basically it is based on the ITC codes. It has a lot of difficulty with customs, they are not able to see which product is coming, what is coming there, how to really identify it. Lot of problems are there. So this is another challenge we are facing. What is the way forward? India needs to implement technical regulations to secure the future and generation quality conscience among its citizens for present and future. This is exactly what we have to think for the future. And let us not forget that stitch in time saves nine. And way forward also is participation in international standardization, systematic review of standards, and harmonize, creating umbrella solution by BIS and reduce number of specifications to remove fragmentation. And need to decentralize licensing bodies to speed up conformity assessment infrastructure. That is very important, because ultimately BIS is also becomes very much loaded, because there's a lot of huge work, if at all you have to really implement the quality standards, because they have to go inspect, check, again monitor that. So we need to decentralize, and this can be done by accrediting some outside bodies, or maybe you can again decentralize and keep more bodies so that they can do this job. ITC mapping the BIS codes for easy trade post control order. This is also important. Again, this is what should not happen. My product services meet standard X. I want to sell them to country B. Country B says that is nice, but we are only accept products or services that meet standard Y. This is the really focal point, that whatever we are making should be acceptable to generally to our end user segment, whether it is global or whether it is domestic. That's what exactly we have to really strive for the future. Thank you very much, sir.
Let me tell you, today, okay, you can use archaic, but I just want to tell you that the speed of innovation today is just so fast that no matter how recent your standard is, it is already old, because innovation in steel today is, and as we were talking about the automobile industry, is just so dynamic that standards only try to catch up with what has been innovated upon. So while I do admit that some of our standards need to be revisited, and I think BIS is perpetually trying to redo the standards, but perpetually updated grades are being done. We had actually had recent discussions with BIS as to how many you have done in the past. We just took a sample of 2 years, and we were surprised as to the number that was added. But I think the variety, we have 141 standards, and I will not even risk how many grades we already have, and add to that how many are not there. Our technical committee has been working for about 7 months right now. And in that short while, we've been able to identify 700 different types, I wouldn't even bother calling them grades, types of steel which have not yet been mapped, and that list is only growing. It's not that the standard or the grade does not exist, but the innovation is so fast. And in the modern technology, more and more requirements are there to change the steel. So whatever we do, I assure you, we will always remain archaic or prehistoric, because there is always a task to be done. We are also, yeah. But let me tell you, ISO is also facing the similar dilemma, because we find so many are not even mapped in ISO. You know, so it is, I think that is some, I think that is a realization everybody who's worked in this niche area will know, that a standard is a catch-up exercise. It cannot be made in advance to something which does not exist. Yes. Also, the point when we talk about mapping of HS codes with BIS, it is a Herculean task. We have in the ministry decided to undertake to map all the 141 standards to the HS codes. It is really a Herculean task. But we do not, I know we've been seeking your assistance in that regard. We do not see a shortcut in this. The HS codes, it's an international system. They exist. They cannot be varied. The IS standards pretty much match what exists in the ISO. We are not making them in isolation. We do mapping with the ISO. We do not create them totally at variance with the ISO. It is. So this is a strange sort of hybrid task we have to do of matching one with the other. It does create problems at the customs. I think everybody in this room will appreciate that. It just adds to, I mean, we do not and cannot think at this stage of how to simplify this. A more exhaustive mapping, there was talk, do we take it to further digits? Does that help? There was a talk from Commerce, do we reduce the digits? Does that help? So the discussions are as varied as making it 12 digits to versus making it 4 digits. We seek the help of the House here to help us, you know, solve this particular dilemma. It is pretty much there. You talked to us about exports to countries like Japan and Korea. I think we must appreciate that these countries are developed countries in terms of production of steel. Their requirements are strong. Their products, their specifications and processes are strong. I mean, we are most welcome and we must try to export to these countries, but these are countries which actually have higher capacities to what is actually their consumption requirement. So they have, I wouldn't even call it excess capacity, it is just they are today the exporters to the rest of the world for high-end steel. We do try to make high-end steels in the countries so that we can provide what these countries are also providing. To breach into these countries and provide a particular steel which is not available to them domestically, it's a tall order. To set our export targets and eye Japan and Korea and feel that we are not being able to export the country, I don't know, I think it's a challenge for the producers, but it's a tough challenge. But there is a whole world out there where otherwise you could export, which are looking for the quality steels being produced in the country. I think we are still in a position to export to a lot of fellow developing countries, our regional countries. I think there is talk and there is a possibility there. Even if we are not doing too well with Korea and Japan, I think that's really setting the standard and the bar for a country which has already got high capacities. So I wouldn't take that as a real negative. I think moving forward, we'll ask MRAI, Mr. Amar Singh, to talk to us about the quality standard.
Please on the dais. A very good afternoon. Madam, scrap, steel scrap, 40% of the steel scrap is being used in total steel production in India as on today. Scrap comes from two sources. One is domestic, second is imports. As per the estimates which is given by JPC, for 53 million tons of scrap is required by 2021 and 2022. But the domestic availability of the scrap is around 44 million, and there is a huge deficit of 9 million tons, which I appreciate government that they have taken a very nice step coming up with draft scrap steel policy. Also, Niti Aayog, they are working on material recycling policy. If these two policies are implemented in India, this deficit will go down. This deficit of 9 million metric ton will go down. But for the time being, Madam, it is a humble request to the government that import duty on metal scrap, which is 2.5%, should be immediately removed so that good quality metal scrap can be imported in India and it can further help in producing good quality steel. When I talk about domestic scrap, there are three kinds of scrap: home scrap, new scrap, and old scrap. Home scrap is the scrap which is generated in the industry. New scrap is the punchings and other material. And old scrap are the scrap which are going to unorganized sector, madam, which is approximately 10 million tons. Madam, if this scrap can be segregated in a much better way, I can say whatever there is problem in the quality of scrap will be passed. So through this stage, I request you that you should put a note to Ministry of Finance, first, for reducing the duty of 2.5%, and second, that scrap should be segregated in an organized manner. Thank you so much.
The Ministry of Steel actually acting as a facilitator to take up all kind of concerns regarding steel scrap, you know, with all the authorities concerned. We are always available for dialogue, and I think we will keep this interaction alive. It's dynamic. We will always seek what all the kind of inputs that will be given to carry the agenda forward. I think scrap is very important for now. That's why it's called a secondary input. It's now the resource that the country will look forward to for further production of steel. It is scrap which renders the steel actually a green product. The fact that it can save resources, it can be used again and again, adhere to the 6R principles. Thank you for your inputs, and we look forward to the whole house actually giving its stakeholder comments on the draft steel scrap policy, which has been posted on the Ministry of Steel website. If anybody has anything further to suggest on that policy, we welcome all inputs, and we will definitely try to incorporate it when we finalize the scrap steel scrap policy. Thank you.
Madam, I want to add,
because shipbuilding as an agenda item, no, it is not with the Ministry of Steel. It is actually with the Ministry of Shipping in our allocation of business rules. You know, that has, it has, no, it has other elements, radioactive, etc., which are concerns which only that ministry helps.
Madam, I want to make one point. I was going through the draft steel scrap policy. First, there was nothing written on the reduction in import duties. And second, I want to make one more point, that the scrap, there should be no standards on scrap, as it is a homogeneous product. ISRI has already issued certain guidelines, specifications for scrap, which should be used in India as well, because many of our producers are buying scrap, taking consideration of that ISRI specs.
ISRI classification, we are aware of, and these are voluntary acceptance. They're not made mandatory anywhere in the world. Anybody who is importing can always ask the exporter to actually do it as per the ISRI classifications. I think BIS is also sensitized on the issue, and we realize that it is such a heterogeneous topic that it is difficult for us to have a standard. It is only a classification, and we are totally guided by the ISRI classifications, but ISRI also holds it as a voluntary compliance. So I think we will all stay on board with the ISRI classifications. When you talk about this import duty, in our scrap policy, we talk about a continuous interaction with Ministry of Finance. By this, we do not talk about a one-time reduce from 5 to 2.5, 2.5 to 0. It is that it will require a continuous interaction, even if it is for inviting further investments into scrapping industry, into shredding industry. So it is a continuous exercise that we will, you know, an engagement. We will have with different ministries to ensure that the scrap quality is good and the supply of scrap is sufficient and that it is done in the environmentally sound fashions. Thank you. Ashwini, I would now request. Ashwini is another person who helps us. Imports are coming into the country. Ashwini, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to everyone. So we have discussed about the how to adopt the quality control order. So first quality control order, which was issued in the March 2012, and after that, over a period, many standards have been introduced. Prior to that March 2012, every steel producer used to produce the steel as per their own specification, own grades, and there were many, many discrepancies among the customers that how to understand that someone is producing the different nomenclature. And so it has helped a lot to the steel consumers as well as steel industry. They have come onto the board and lot of licenses have been issued and people have taken. But the issue at present, it has already more than 7 years that specifications and mandatory control order has been issued. How to find that implementation part? We are not knowing that whether the people who have the license, whether they are producing the material as per the specification and supplying in the market. Of course, in the test certificate, when you see, there is a marking given on that, and emblem is there, everything is there. But whether the material conforms to that or not, when you check the material, then you find that there is a discrepancy. So it is requested to the government, that is, of course, the BIS, to find out a procedure that enforcement to be done and regular check with the suppliers has to be done, whether they are adopting this or getting this material as per the specification, whether they have proper checks at their end in the process as well as the testing method. So this is the major point I would like to emphasize. Otherwise, everything has been talked about that we have to adopt and we have to produce the material as per the quality. And as Madam has told that we are part of that technical committee where we are seeing that the material which is coming into the country, they also should have the quality as far as, and plus steel industry should also produce those material which are getting imported. So this is my just suggestion, that's all. Thank you very much.
Mrs. Govil, dignitaries on the dais, my good friends in audience, Mr. Das, Dr. Shubh Gautam, friends. I just, firstly, let me thank, you know, that it's very well managed conference. And I think it is a very crucial topic which you have selected, the BIS quality standards and how it is applicable to India. Dr. Shubh Gautam had touched on this topic, you know, the definition of quality. And I would like to go to basics. If you Google it, what is the definition of quality? It will say, you know, it is meeting customers' expectation. So quality is defined by what the customer wants or what is good enough for the customer. Now, having said that, in India, we have, do we tell a customer, you know, that, you know, we are drinking water from this mineral water? In a village, we tell them that you please, because this is good for health, that you please drink only mineral water. Or vice versa, radial tires were they were brought in for Formula One, but that was ultimately used in nano car also. So it is the customer who decides what quality is required. Having said that, now I'll come to whether quality control order is, what are the objectives of the quality control order? There are a few, when I came in at 11 o'clock, one speaker was saying that a lot of substandard material is coming into India. And, you know, that is one of the objective. Let me say that substandard material is not coming. In one of the slides I just saw that GPGC, and they say defective sheets have come 150,000 tons. The nomenclature is wrong. no GPGC sheet are coming because it is under BIS IS-277. It is electrogal or galva annealed, Dr. Shubh Gautam. It is electrogal or galva annealed material which is coming, and mainly it is coming from Japan and Korea. And it is wonderful material. It is seconds material, overrolling material. However, so the nomenclature is wrong, so it gives a completely different picture. Defect, zero effect policy, which we completely agree that we should, you know, have the final product which is you know, conforming to certain standard, but that is final product. Can we tell Tata Motors or Volkswagen or Hyundai what material to use, what raw material to use? They know it very well. What IS-513 grades to be used, or what under IS-2062 to be used? They know it. So, and this is the, you know, top of the pyramid. I am going to the bottom of the pyramid. Even a rolling shutter manufacturer would know what material to be used. So let us not go into that. However, you know, I think the quality standards have been implemented. It is for the good of the country. It is for the good of the steel industry. And a lot of water has flown under the bridge, so we cannot go back. We cannot reverse it. But what essentially it is doing, Mrs. Govil, I just want to make a point here, that it is basically, it is not allowing better quality material to be used by the final product manufacturers. This is essentially what it is doing. Let us assume there is a component manufacturer who, with innovation, they have some orders, and that material either is not being manufactured in India or not competitively manufactured, or the quantities are not great that the mills will not like to manufacture. Does he wait for the mills to manufacture those products, which is a higher quality grade, or does he import it, use it, and then you know, put it in the Indian market or for export? Now, you have to go to Ministry of Steel or BIS, and you know, there are circulars where, you know, we have said notified certain grades would not be under the, you know, quality standards. But that process takes a lot of time. So what is the solution? Product user industry. Let us make it steel user specific. It is very, very important. It is also important if you see Make in India initiative, you know, because in Make in India, if anybody wants to define Make in India, Dr. Mukesh Kumar knows, we had discussion on this. What does Make in India mean? Make in India means, in one single line, is that we want to make each and every enterprise in India globally competitive. This is our duty to give them those conditions so that they become globally competitive. If we put these kind of restrictions, then perhaps I doubt that, you know, they may not become globally competitive. So first and foremost, let us, you know, exempt from this quality control order the well-known international standards. That will take care of a lot of things. That will take care of a lot of issues with the auto industry also. Secondly, there is also one provision where the distributor is open to scrutiny. A stockist distributor is open to scrutiny by an officer of BIS. Now, the material which he is getting from a mill, and let any of this kind of restriction or regulation be at the door of the mill. So whatever a mill is producing, the mill is responsible for that, whether it adheres to a particular standard or no. A distributor cannot change chemical or mechanical properties of steel. So let it not, because that prevents people to say that, look, this is not an edible oil or something which I can, you know, add something and, you know, change. But this is steel, so why should I be responsible? These two issues, these need to be really looked into, and I would request Ministry of Steel to look into this. So going forward, I think there would be a lot of questions on quality control order, but I feel that today, whatever the government has done, you know, since 2012, where most of the products now have been covered under quality control order. However, there are some niche products which, you know, there are non-critical applications. And I would suggest that especially those non-critical applications are the production is being done by SME, MSME segment. There, you know, the quality control order needs to be looked into in a different way. Thank you very much.
Mr. Turki has raised a lot of controversial and important points. I think now the discussion's really got going. Okay, when you talk about well-known international standards and when we talk about exempting them from our own standards and accepting an international standard, sir, I would like to ask you, has any country done that for any other country?
No, I'm saying why should we be following anybody? Why don't we have our own set of things?
Yes,
we are
sir.
Not following anybody.
Yes, sir.
Till we reach, when BIS becomes exhaustive or everybody is using BIS standards in the world, you know, we will have to follow, as we all agree, that Japan is much ahead of us in terms of quality, or Korea is much ahead of us in terms of quality.
Sir,
so
here,
why don't we...
I appreciate the point that, sir, you're mentioning. It is not a question of who's following or who's leading. Here, what happens is each country has its international it has its standards, which are reasonably aligned to international standards. And each country has used quality control orders, if I can say so candidly to the House, as TRQs. These are non-tariff barriers which are imposed. Each country is perpetually upgrading its orders, its standards, its grades. When we talk about a make in India, we talk about not just downstream. It is that every kind of product can be produced in the country. I think I started by saying that we are reasonably a developed country in terms of steel. We do have capacity and we do have producers ready to produce all kinds of grades. They have to be given an opportunity, a market, to actually produce that possible steel in the country. Failing which, when there are not sufficient domestic producers, when there are not sufficient licenses, we do allow, we do give exemptions, we do defer the application of quality control orders to allow an import for a specific purpose to come into the country. But if we were not to create that market, if we were to allow any kind of what we call superior, I mean, that is also question mark, whether it is superior or whether it is just something which needs to be produced by somebody in the country. If we do not give that opportunity, we will not have a case of our domestic steel industry catching up with what has already been achieved by higher quality producers, other countries, if I can say, namely Japan or Korea, etc. And I think the country has met this challenge very effectively in the past 10, 12 years. We've had Mr. Datta from Hyundai, who talks about now we are at 94% indigenization of the steel for automobiles. It leaves only another 6% that needs to be conquered, produced by our domestic thing. If we were not to have a situation of our own BIS, our own quality control orders, I think it is Mr. Das here, Mr. ACR Das, he started in 2012 by suggesting that we start having quality control orders. Today we are looking at 53 products that is standards covered. I think by the end of the evening you'll have 13 more. I think it's a very good day when Monica's had this particular conference. By the end of the evening you'll probably see 13 more standards coming under the quality. That takes it to 66 out of 140 odd. There is a case to cover more and more products, to catch up with wherever we have not produced, to produce. So while we appreciate there are concerns for the downstream producers to talk about whether it is produced or not produced in the country, wherever we are found lacking, we do work towards allowing an import of that in the country. To your second point, which you're raising about critical and non-critical applications, I think there is nothing known as non-critical application. If anybody is buying any product, he is entitled to have the best quality. To say that somebody could, some particular usage requires a better quality and somebody else can do with an inferior quality, I think, sir, that is a situation where you compromise your expectations. I think when all of us go out, we want the superior quality in everything that we buy. So, sir, I would suggest that we work towards a quality regime. I think that is what my minister also mentioned in the morning, that let's work towards everything having a certain quality standard. Let's not in our minds call something critical or non-critical. Yes, our MSME sector should not be hurt in any fashion. They should also be given an opportunity to work with the best quality material so that that particular product which they make is called a quality product. Not that just because it was produced by an MSME, chances are it is not a very good product because it is considered a non-critical application which has used an input material which is not as superior as what was produced by a non-MSME producer, and that product is better. I think we need to bring everybody at par for a quality regime in the country. We can discuss this further. I think I will invite you into the country for that regard.
Definitely.
Mr. Sood, just wait for 2 more minutes because I think Mr. Suri would like to leave. I think he's in a bit of a rush. We'll have an open house discussion thereafter. Yeah, I think we'll. I heard that you were in rush. Yeah.
I'm Ruchika, madam, and the audience and the dignitaries on the dais. Yes. I think we're running behind schedule. The next session also needs to be starting soon. So let me be very brief. We all know about GST, One Nation, and how it is in operation now, and it's something that is gonna stay. But a year before that, quality control order in stainless steel was notified. And this was also basically in line with zero defect and make in India for the world. Not just make in India, but make in India for the world. That means we as a country, we as steel company, we as steel users should start getting into the habit of using only quality products. Quality products, yes, as somebody defined, is something which the customer wants, but also must conform to certain standards which are uniformly acceptable to one and all. While GST Council is very proactive and smart, I would say our quality control regime is a little slow and sluggish. I mean, we are very reactive. We are not proactive. When we started, ACR Das was there, and I must compliment him. We started off pretty well. Our standards were as old as 1992, and they had to be brought at par with the global standards prevailing in 2016. So to begin with, many exemptions were given. And then thereafter, the standards were revised by ACR Das, and the process continues. Even now, more and more products are being added, as everyone knows. I'll now give a small example. In one of the conferences, Madam was the chairperson, and Madam shared one personal example. She said that I bought stainless steel utensil, and in 3 months it cracked. Now, stainless steel is something which should last beyond 100 years. And here it did not last beyond 100 days. So what was the reason? I told her that more than 50% of stainless steel used in India for consumer durables is non-standard. We have a quality control order which specifies very clearly that utensils should be made with this particular standard grade, where Rohit would confirm that ISDA took 4 years to formulate that standard through submission of so many samples, testing, etc., etc., because this is something which is to be used for hygiene, to be used for food. So 50% of stainless steel for people like you and me being allowed to be used, I think it's unpardonable. Madam, I need your support there to ensure that this 50% market of stainless steel is banned, because this is very important. Somebody was telling me yesterday, we had a CII stainless steel conference, and we were having a debate with the steel secretary, and we were told that, you know, poor people, affordability. Well, if you use stainless steel specified by BIS for manufacturing of utensils, probably the cost difference is not more than 10%. So why do we want to say that a poor person in our country is entitled to poor quality? And that poor quality has hurt you also, ma'am, and it has hurt me also. I have also seen my utensils cracking at home. So we need to be very firm, and we need to ban the use of non-standard stainless steel in the country. Not only use, but even manufacturing. Nothing is getting imported. Everything is getting produced in India and being used by the downstream sector, and the innocent people like all of us sitting around here and people there below the poverty line being taken for a ride. I am supporting quality control order. I think it's a very good thing that has happened for the country, and I'm very happy that only BIS certified countries are allowed to operate in our country. And going forward, this would really help us to create a brand which is India. So the capital goods sector that I represent, we are compliant. We are extremely compliant with the government policies. And if the consumer sector is not compliant, what happens, madam, is that these sheets start coming into the capital goods sector also. And capital goods sector is very critical when it comes to performance, when it comes to safety. And therefore, it's really important that we stop this non-standard circulation of stainless steel. I mean, if you go and talk to the small MSME guys, they buy, let us say, a grade which is austenitic, and they want to buy from company X. He will be told, yes, this is the grade that you're getting, but probably he'll get ferritic. He will get the test certificate, which is also fake. So if every manufacturer is BIS certified, if every end user is using certified material, I think all these safety related issues will be a thing of the past. Another thing which Ravinder Bhan mentioned is about grade equivalent. If we have a grade which is introduced in BIS standard, at the same time we must, at least they must know, the BIS must know, Steel Ministry must know, what is the equivalent in ASTM, what is the equivalent maybe in GIS or European norms. You talked about new products. I just want to add one thing. If new products don't come into the country, and if there is no demand created for the new product, there is very little incentive for the domestic industry to start producing that grade or that product. Because the product which is made in Japan or in Europe is being globally supplied. Any manufacturer who makes 140 tons in a furnace is able to sell 140 tons across the globe. Now, if somebody, let's say Jindal has to make 140 tons, and there is a demand for 10 tons, what will you do with 130 tons? So we must allow new products to come into the country so that the ball grows bigger, and then the domestic industry intervenes. I think that answers your objection to entry of new products into the country. So my net advice or request to you would be, please ban non-standard stainless steel in the country. Thank you very much.
Stainless steel should not be allowed in the country. Equally important, non-standard stainless steel produced by domestic producers is also to be shut down in the country. It applies both ways. On your second point, which you just raised towards the end, that if the demand in the country is small, allow it to be imported. I think here it's a very debatable issue whether the example that you've given is 140 tons done by Jindal's and 10 is the demand. We are not talking only the large producers here. Today we have a very mature industry of small producers. There is a lot of producers who are producing at less than 1 million tons, at 500,000 tons, and in fact even smaller than that. There is a case for them, and especially as I'm told that the mini blast furnace, the electric arc furnace, etc., they are the industry which is actually, even in fact, even in Japan, they are the ones which actually produce the high end and the alloy steels. It is for this industry that there has to be created a space for them to actually have a mature market, for them to actually tie up and produce that product. If it doesn't suit the interest of the large producer, let him not produce it. But that does not mean that the smaller producer should not be given an opportunity to produce that. I think one important point that we find is when the consumer in the country is so small, and I have a case where the foreign licensor, a foreign manufacturer, is not interested in the license. What do I do about a case like that? That causes a dilemma to us in the ministry. The demand in the country is small. We put a quality control order. We expect that the foreign supplier must actually get a license. The foreign manufacturer says, you are too small, I'm not interested in going through your entire licensing procedure. Then we are stuck. We have to then probably create exemptions for a certain short period of time till we are able to get somebody in the domestic market, whether a large producer or a small producer, who raises his hands and is willing to meet the demand. This is a challenge which I face when I look at my Make in India, that I do not want my downstream industry actually hurt by a quality control order. And we do come across cases of very, very small demands. But having said that, there is a complete thinking that quality is required across the board. Exceptions are something which we can look at to create niche, to step out of the purview of quality control orders once they are in place, only for specific requirements. But only this will actually encourage everybody to follow quality, either in imports or domestically. And this import TRQ is actually a very short play instrument, because once you have a quality control order, yes, a non-licensed import cannot come in. But once somebody was to seek a license, in that particular case, license can be procured in 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, but eventually the license gets procured if he's following good practices, especially when we are looking at high-grade steels coming in from the developed world. So it is actually just in that window you create an opportunity for the domestic industry to take up this product, develop in the product, and provide it domestically. Because as producers tell me, traders tell me, that it is expensive to import, and the logistic cost, the costs in times when by the time you place an order, 4 months later it comes, you clear the customs, etc. He said, I would much rather buy it in the country if I'm assured of the product. So here I think today the movement is to repose that confidence in our domestic producers, go upstream, go high end, go for the quality niche. As you were mentioning, that there is, I think the large producers are producing the large quantities. There is no doubt that those are quality products they are coming in. What about the alloy steels and the high-end steels? I think the whole forum, the whole debate is only regarding that. I think now we've reached the level of maturity where we can expect that to happen.
Yeah. Ma'am, just 60-second addition, for the clarity. Mr. Suri very rightly pointed out that in the utensil industry there are certain grades. There are certain grades which are being imported or produced domestically, also leading to some issues of quality like cracking, he mentioned. So keeping in view, BIS has taken this task in the last year to standardize those grades in a way whether it is suitable for consumption or not. So that, as I said, a dynamic process. That process is on to standardize those 50% also. Yes. Thank you.
Rajiv, you have the honor of being the last speaker.
Yeah, I am the last speaker now. Yeah. I see. On the quality control order, I should say that there should be a system called quality control order management. The most important thing, the management is missing here. There should be we should help the companies here to get certified for the BIS certification. as well as who are not having a BIS certification but not following the what you call the norms, then we need to have surveillance to monitor them. And another most important thing which I understand that apart from a defective material, there are a lot of superior quality material coming into the country. So to understand the, like Mr. Nikunj was telling, that there are certain superior galva-annealed material is coming, galva-alum material is coming, electro-galvanized materials are coming. Maybe they are quite superior to the normal material. So how do we know that they are superior? Then we need to go to the customers. We need to know who are there, how they are using it, and this will actually form the QCO management system. So I understand that India actually is still in the nation building stage. We are not producing all products which are necessarily required by the country. We are producing in the steel sector, I think we are producing about 96 or 95%. The five remaining 5% we need to produce. I think the secondary steel sector is should be asked to produce, and we need to help them how to produce those quantities, because this for the integrated steel plants, these are not economical orders. They will be reluctant to produce them. So we should ask them to change their processes, steel making processes. And when they are able to change over to the steel making process, they may be able to produce high value added products, and automatically their bottom line will improve, and they will mature, and it will be helping in Make in India. It will generate employment, and this is basically what you call if we manage quality control order well, then these are the benefits we will get. So I think with this, and I think this quality, what you call, is sort of a high jump. See, there is a barrier and there is a system of measuring. See, somebody jumps, there is a barrier, somebody jumps, we know that, and if he is able to cross the barrier, then he is better, then we put the barrier at a higher level. So this is the way we see the what is quality. Quality always should be measurable. That's what I mean by that. This, and with this, I thank. I end my close my remarks.
Yeah, thank you, Rajiv.
We are manufacturer of heavy machinery, which is used in fertilizer plant, power projects, and refineries. And now we are entering into capital goods which can be used in nuclear power projects. Largely we are buying indigenous steel, but some of the steel which is not manufactured in India, special quality, controlled chemistry, incoloys, where nickel, chromiums are very high, not manufactured. Now for that we have to come to you always for the clarification. Now once a clarification is given that this specification is outside, still it is conditional that for every consignment we have to come to you. For every consignment when we come to you, you need mill test certificate. And mill test certificate we get from the overseas mill by the time the goods have arrived. And we have no time to seek the clarification, goods keep on incurring damage, everything. So can you, those specifications which are deemed as outside, can you notify that this, we should not come repetitively and
yes, sir. Sir, we appreciate this question has been raised to us at many a fora, and we get these requests. We have actually, in that portal, firstly, you can take a clarification in advance before your consignment comes in. This is if it's in anticipation that am I covered or am I not covered. Once we will give you that clarification that no, you're not covered by the quality control order, but that is not for an import purpose. That is just for your information that yes, we will not hold you covered by a QCO when you will bring in your particular consignment. Then when your consignment is to come in, you will put in your mill test certificate of the consignment that is coming in, and based on the earlier clarification, if it is the same chemistry, we will hold it that it is not. You will get it much faster. And when you are coming to for repeat consignments. We assure you that within the week, you will get your clarifications. Currently, we take anywhere from 1 week to 40 days. That is because the technical committee holds its meeting either once a month or twice a month, depending on the workload that we have. But now that we've been in existence for 6 to 8 months, we have now understood the nature of our work, understood the nature of our clarifications. We have worked out this portal, which will thereafter enable you to feed in your data, upload your documents, and repeat cases when we see there's a pattern. The same mill test certificate, the same consignment, same importer, same exporter coming in. We meaning here the BIS and the Ministry of Steel, will together allow you to bring it. So you must appreciate that it is very difficult for us to put it on an exemption list. As we have discussed time and again, that here there is a reason why we are doing this exercise. It is not to actually cause any problems to you in procuring the material. It is actually towards encouraging our own industry to also to enable them to service your needs. If you have a requirement, let somebody have an opportunity to make that particular product. So therefore, when we allow you, and I mean, we don't want to create hurdles in the work, we want to facilitate it faster. With the coming of this portal, within 10 days, you can upload a repeat case and I assure you that you will get your clarifications within the week. I don't think we can do anything more than that in this regard, because you have to appreciate that these are in the nature of non-tariff barriers. It is only in exceptional cases that nobody in the country is making it, or you need an aerospace certification, you need a nuclear certification, etc., that this is being allowed in your particular case, because there is no producer in the country.
It is used by the manufacturer like us. You see, we have at our manufacturing plant Lloyds permanently stationed as inspection. Nothing can enter unless the Lloyds clear. We give performance guarantee. We are answerable for the equipment for many, many years. Who knows better than us what quality should we do? I mean, you should exempt the equipment manufacturers like us from BIS. I mean, we know what to buy. We know what to use. We are responsible for the equipment for their life.
You see, unfortunately, the kind of material that is being, I agree that it in your personal production, it may create some difficulties. We've tried to facilitate it. By the time your consignment leaves a port, by the time it reaches the Indian port, if it is a case that does require an exemption, within the week we decide to give, I mean, we assure you that we will give you the exemption. I don't think the government can do anything more than that. It is not a case of this thing. I think, sir, you are together, so let somebody else have an opportunity to raise the point. No, we'll just take another line. We've understood your line, and I think we've done maximum to this. Mr. Sood has been asking for some time. Yes, Mr. Sood.
It is all said that is basically for the domestic industry, so that quality products, BIS quality products, are only produced in India. But over the period of the way the discussions are taking place, and which we had been also maintaining, that it has been basically not that purpose. It was basically a TBT. And TBT means basically curtail on the imports, which Mr. Bhan has said, yes, it is basically. So we do agree that it is basically a TBT, because even in the domestic industry today, I don't think we are really enforcing it, because in any manufacturing process, about 5 to 10% will definitely go as non-BIS. And I'm sure none of the manufacturers here may be making this 5 to 10% scrap. Because that 5 to 10% scrap, if you make it scrap, it is highly uneconomical. And again, what we're talking about, it is an application which matters. Now, the same diversions, not necessarily it should be made as scrap. It can very well go for the non-critical applications. And non-critical applications can be maybe color-coded or GP, GC sheet. It could be used as a barrier. Some such sheets can be used as the fencing. Some packaging can be used as the packaging material. So these applications can always go for the non-critical use. These are all non-critical applications.
Yeah.
And it will be wrong to say that the downstream industry they produce for the non-critical applications. I am from the downstream industry, cold rolling industry, and we do cater to the needs of the auto industry, engineering industry, and it is basically critical, non-critical. It can be applicable to the main producer, it could be made applicable to the downstream industry as well.
We totally endorse that point of view. When we bring about a quality control order, we expect even the domestic producer must adhere to the quality expected in the standard. In this regard, we would like to say that till 2016, it is only BIS which had to carry out the complete surveillance mechanism. There was no way they could have given it to anybody. That is as prior to this BIS 2016 Act. With the coming of this 2016 Act, which came into operation in 2017, now there exists a provision that the central government may, actually is in section 16.2, allow somebody else to carry out this exercise to ensure that there is good quality production happening. I think BIS is very aware of the fact that this surveillance mechanism needs to be stepped up now that we are at a very advanced stage of imposing more and more quality control orders in a large number of areas. You will see surveillance stepped up. I think steel is where we have the maximum quality control orders. So it is an authority comfortable with doing the surveillance of steel, which will have to be given the task of undertaking this mission to make sure that only quality steel is produced, point one. Point two, when you talk about non-critical applications of steel, as we've discussed earlier, that if you allow steel which is not up to the mark, not up to the standard, not up to the grade, and if that is allowed to move into the market, how do we expect anybody to monitor where that steel really goes? It is only at the producer stage you say that if this does not match, there exists a quality control order, you do not make up to this particular standard, in that particular case, the material is seconds defective, it should not find itself in the market. To trace that particular steel, to see where it went, whether it was critical, not critical, who is to judge what is critical and what is not to be critical, a GPGC sheet, the example that you're giving it, put it along the roadside. If it was to malfunction in whichever fashion, who it hurts, I think that's where moral judgments come in, and I don't think we are in a position to take moral judgments in that regard. It's not up to the mark, it is seconds, it's defective, it is therefore equal to scrap, it has to go back. Luckily for us, it is a recyclable product, put it back in the furnace, go make better steel out of it, it meets the mark, and therefore only then it is marketable. I think Mr. Bhan would like to also add to this.
So used within the country, as well as whatever import comes, it is conform to a standard. And as per WTO regulations, whatever is applied outside abroad, it has to apply domestically for domestic industries also. That is a regulation. It is basically to get quality products maybe abroad or within India. I am just clarifying.
The innovation in steel is happening very fast, in fact a bit too fast for the BIS to catch up, which means that we are actually using an inferior standard to prevent a superior standard. I think that's a very big anomaly that's happening.
It's not an anomaly, it's a perpetual catch-up.
Yeah, perpetual catch-up.
It's a perpetual catch-up.
Yeah, so when we are
it's just the rate of catch-up.